So let's start with an easy topic and then we will move to the main topic. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now here comes our next topic, which is personal protective equipment, which is your favorite topic, right? You all yes, love too much with PPE. For everything, use PPE. For everything, use PPE. Right? So, as required by OSHA General Industry Standard 1910, Section 9132, employer must protect employees from workplace hazards. See, even OSHA is going to guide you that before using a PPE or before, recommending a PPE, first, you need to apply other controls. The requirement of PPE comes from where? Who is going to tell you that you have to use the PPE for this activity or when you are using the equipment? Who tells you?
Safety manager?
No.
Employer?
No.
Yourself, you have to.
No.
Provider?
No.
Safety management?
No.
Not employer?
Not employer. Your risk assessment is going to tell you that you have to use the PPE.
Yes.
Promise. Right? Because when we are going to apply the controls against the hazards, which we have identified for the different areas, then our risk assessment is going to guide you that we need to use the PPE. Okay. If we don't have the risk assessment, then we will be using the PPEs without any justification, just on the request of safety manager or safety department or the employer. So, which is highly unacceptable. If you are using the PPE, you should have a valid argument why you are using the PPE. We have seen in many companies just to show off they are wearing the helmet. Even there is no need to wear the helmet, but since their management, they like to wear the helmet, so all the employees are wearing helmet. So once the supervisor is going to leave or some, when the safety officer is not available, all of them, they remove the helmet. And once anyone comes, again, they are wearing the helmet. So this should not be the culture. We need to develop the culture. So the people are taking the responsibility by themselves. The people are going to own. And this will be done by our risk assessment, right? This will be done by our risk assessment. So our risk assessment will tell us that which kind of control we are going to apply. And the last line of control is our PPE, right? So as required by OSHA standard, we need to have the PPE plan available. The PPE plan, what is PPE plan available? Program. PPE program is a very simple program where you are going to identify different activities where you are going to use the different type of PPEs, how many persons are going to use the PPEs, and what should be the minimum stock available. Because PPE is not like any of the machine part that if the part is not available, so machine is going to stop. When you are working on site, when you are working in the operations area, then you need to use the PPE. Otherwise, the accident is waiting for you, right? This is the last line of control. After the PPE, we have accident. So there are many kinds of PPE available. Nowadays, everyone is aware of the PPE, especially PPE is related to the mask and PPE is related to the gloves. So PPE, we also call it then barrier devices, right? Which are barrier between you and other human. So we have PPEs for eyes, for example, safety glasses, goggles. For face, we have face shield. For head, we have hard hats or helmets. For feet, we have safety shoes. For hands and arms, we have gloves. For bodies, we have vest. For hearing purpose, we are using ear plug or ear muff. Then there are some other PPEs also. For example, safety harness, safety belt, full body harness. Similarly, we have the coverall. These are all different kind of PPEs. Then there are different kind of masks which are available.
Masks.
Exactly. right? So there are number of examples which are available for the PPEs. So as I told you that you, as required by OSHA, the employer has to identify the where are the locations where they are going to use the PPE, and this will be mentioned in our PPE program, right? And this PPE program shall be available. And very important thing about PPE, that when we are providing the PPEs, we need to teach our people that how to use this PPE. What is the correct way of using the PPE? Because we have seen many times that the workers are using the PPEs due to the fear of safety manager, rather than they are, you know, aware of what will be the consequences if they are not going to use the PPE. So this is a very dangerous situation, because whenever the safety manager or safety officer is not available, they are going to bypass the safety. Many times we have seen that the workers are under pressure from their supervisors to not use the PPE, because it will be wasting much time. So they are bypassing the safety. So PPE usage training is very necessary. Have you seen, when you are passing through any of the area in your, you know, in your locality, at your residential area, you will find many masks on the roads, gloves, use mask. So why this is going to be happen? Because due to the government restriction, we are using the mask, but we are not being trained on using the mask. We don't know how to save the mask. We don't know how to discard the mask. Some of us, they know it, so they are going to keep it on the dustbin. But many of us, we don't care about these things. And basically, if someone has corona disease and he is going to throw his mask on the road or at any place, so definitely the virus is going to spread in other areas, in several places. So this is also our ethical responsibility, that we need to take care for these small things. So it will not cause you any, in terms of finance or in terms of money, but it's a very good practice. It's an ethical responsibility for us, that when we are going to throw out our mask or gloves, we need to throw them in a safe manner. So it will not get problem for anyone. This should not spread our virus or our contagious disease if we have to others. So training of PPEs are very necessary. Have you seen on construction site that the people are workers, when they are working on height, they are using the full body harness, but they don't attach it with the lanyard. Sometimes they are wearing the same full body harness, but they are wearing it in an improper way. Have you seen sometimes workers, they are wearing the safety shoes, but they are wearing the safety shoes like a slipper, especially when they are going for salah or when they are going to washroom. After that, they come out and they just tilt out their shoes from the backside, it can be removed easily whenever it is needed. So they are not fulfilling the purpose of that PPE. So we need to guide them, and this is a continuous process. We need to guide them again and again, again and again, again and again. So this will be in their mind, in their hearts and mind, that we are using the PPE for a purpose. We are using the PPE not due to the company policy only. We have seen some companies who have initiated the PPE program, PPE awareness among their staff, and those staff, and they have the staff which were not be able to remove their, you know, shumal from their heads. They say, this is our pride. We cannot remove this. But due to their continuous efforts, showing them the videos of accident, showing them the videos of awareness, giving them rewards and recognition, after 3 years, after 2 years, they have realized that the change has started, right? So when the people are using the PPEs, due to their understanding of health and safety, they think that this PPE is going to protect me, then he will be wearing or she will be wearing that PPE all the time. But if they are being used PPEs due to the forceful action by the company, then whenever there is no inspector, whenever there is no supervisor available, they are going to remove the PPE. And this will cause sometime accident and sometime they are lucky. Right? So most of the PPEs, they have their shelf life, they have their expiry date available. So whenever we get the PPE, we need to check it. We need to ask the manufacturer that what is the life of this PPE and how much time we can use it. Even the gloves, even the helmets, you will find that the there is an expiry available. So those which are disposable, so we need to use them one time and then we need to discard them. Clear?
Clear.
Then we have, in terms of PPEs, eyes, we are using safety spectacles. Safety spectacles, wherever we have metallic chips or wooden chips, when we are working on, especially on the lathe machine, when we are working on the grinding activity, when we are, you know, doing the activities of wooden, like carpentry activities, so we are going to use the safety spectacles. But when we are working with the chemicals, when wherever there is a chance of a splash is there, whenever there is a chance that the particles are very tiny particles are there, they can enter into our eyes with, even if the goggle is there. So in this case, we are going to use the our safety goggles. So which is a more protective, and it will also be covering you from the side, while safety spectacles are not going to cover you from the sides. Then we have face shield. Whenever you are going to perform the welding, cutting, grinding activity, you are going to use the full face shield, which is going to protect your eyes, which is going to protect your full face. Head protection. Head is a very important part of our body. It's one of the most sensitive area, although it's very hard in physically, but if any of the pressure is going to, if there is any pressure or impact which is going to hit our head, it can cause the disturbance of whole body system. If your mind, if the that impact or that injury is on your brain, if that injury is on your skull, so that becomes very difficult for the people to survive, right? Even if without your hand you can survive, without your fingers you can survive, but if the injury is severe, so it is very difficult for the people to survive if it is a head injury. So we have different kind of helmets available. We also call them hard hats, right? If you want, you can take the picture of this slide, because it is not available in the book. This is a new thing that OSHA has now changed the classification of hard hats. Before, it was like G, E, and C. A, B, and C. Now they have given the terminologies with regards to their usage. For example, for general purpose, G for general. So you are going to use the G type classification, which is for the mining, building, construction, shipbuilding, lumbering, and manufacturing. It has good impact protection, but limited voltage protection. Then we have class E, E for electricity. So class B, before it was class B, and now it is class E for electrical work, which is going to save you from the high voltage, which is 20,000 volt. It is going to save you. Then we have class C, which is for the maintenance activity. It is, for example, it's like a bump cap. We call it bump cap. It's not going to support you or going to protect you from the electrical shock, but it has good impact, resistance. Whenever you are working under the machines, for example, in the shutdowns, you are working inside the machine. Sometimes you are working under the machines. Sometimes you are working over the machine. So this bump cap is not much hard or much in weight as compared to the class G helmet, although you can also use the class G helmet, but class C is more recommended because it gives you the protection from all the sides. Its shelter is like the cowboy cap from all over the, like you have the helmets, you have the caps or hats, which has the shelter from all, from the full round over the head, right? So this is the classification of hard hats. Any question?
Sir, the helmet, what's the product? Plastic, aluminium, titanium?
Yeah. Plastic, fiber.
All of the helmets by fiber?
Yeah. Most of them are plastic. Very good type of plastic. Okay.
Thank
all
you.
The fiber.
Got it. Thank you.
Then we have air protectors, hearing protection. There are two kind of hearing protection commonly used, or you can say three types. air muff or air plug. Air plug and air canal are same almost. The purpose is same, but air muff are more, they are going to reduce more noise as compared to air plug. Air muff reduce up to the 30 decibel. The unit for noise is the decibel. dB stands for decibel. So this decibel is the logarithm unit. It's not the simple unit, it's a logarithm unit. So the air muff is going to reduce up to 30 decibel, while air plug is going to reduce up to 15 to 17 decibel. So whenever we are working with the generators, when we are working with the boilers, so they are having a lot of noise, and sometimes machines also having a lot of noise. So in this case, we are going to use the air muff. But if we are dealing with less noisy equipment or less noisy machinery, then we are going to use the air plug. Some injuries of foot. Our foot, since we are working, so we have to walk, we have to work with the whole body. So some of the injuries of foot, they are due to the sharp edges, they are due to the puncturing, they are due to the hot surface, they are due to the slipping or tripping hazards. So we get the injuries in our foot all the time. Safety shoes are a very good protection against these kind of injuries. We have the high toe shoes and we have the low toe shoes. High ankle shoes and low ankle shoes available for the safety purpose. But one thing which is common in all safety shoes is the steel toe, which is steel toe is here. If I can show you, this is our steel toe, right? So steel toe is very necessary part because it is going to protect you from any kind of, if some weight is going to fall on your foot, if any sharp edge is going to fall on your foot, is going to touch with your foot. So this kind of safety shoes are going to protect us. When we are working in oil and gas sector, when we are working at drilling sites, since they have a lot of mud also available, so their shoes are more higher as compared to this high ankle shoes. So depending on your usage, you are going to use wear the safety shoes. But as if you remember on first day, we discussed that as required by OSHA, the safety shoes or any of the PPEs are going to assign to the relevant persons, not to everyone. Clear. Now we have hand protection. Hand protection, our hands are always supporting to our body. Whatever actions we are going to take, we are going to take through our hands. So hands injuries are possible like burns, bruises, abrasions, cutting, puncture, fracture, amputation. Sometimes the body part is going to be away from the body. Chemical exposure. So in industries, at workplaces, we have seen that most of the accidents are causing the hand injuries because the hands are always being used for any of the activity, to perform any of the activity. So our hands are very important. See, those things which are very important, it is being given by our, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as two pair. Eyes are important, so we have two. Hands are important, so we have two. Ears are important, so we have two. But our tongue is least important. That's why if you see the teaching that we need to use this tongue as less as possible. Use your tongue for something good, otherwise keep silent. So that's why we have one tongue. Otherwise we have two ears, two eyes, right? So those things which we are going to utilize too much, these are the two parts, but those things which we need to use as controlled operations, these are being single, right? So for the hands, we are going to use different types of gloves, which includes cut resistant gloves, which includes burn resistant gloves, which include disposable gloves, which if we are dealing with the chemicals, we are going to use the PVC gloves. If we are going to deal with the first aid, or we are going to use the medical waste, then we are going to use the nitrile gloves. So different types of gloves are possible. And as I told you yesterday, that we are going to use the gloves when we are going to purchase the gloves according to their classification. If we are not going to give the correct standard code to our purchase department, procurement department, they are not going to bring the good quality or the correct type of gloves or any of the PPEs. Then we have full body harness. Have you seen this full body harness? Any of you has wear this? This full body harness we are going to use when we are working at height. See, up to 6 feet, when we are working above 6 feet, we are going to use the safety belt. But when we are going to use above 10 feet, we are going to use the full body harness. This full body harness is like a suit. You are wearing the full suit. Your legs will go here. One leg, then second leg. Your hands will be coming out there. This is your belt and this is your on the back, right? So this is a very protective device for those people who are working at height. But many times we have seen in our experience, in our inspection, when we are going for the audits, I have seen many times that the people, they don't know how to use this body harness in an effective way. Sometimes, as I told you, due to the company policy or due to the fear of safety officer, they are going to use the full body harness. So they are using sometimes full body harness without putting their legs into these. Sometimes they are going to use the full body harness and they are not connecting it with the lifeline. So these kind of things are common in companies, in industries. So we need to focus that whenever our people, they are going to use the full body harness, they must be trained. They must be trained on it because they don't feel comfortable when they are using the full body harness. And especially if they are using the full body harness in a wrong way, so it causes them more, problematic. It causes them more exhaustion. They don't feel comfortable with it. So that's why many times they avoid to wear the full body harness. Rather, they just use the safety belt, which is up to here only, up to here. Safety belt is up to here. It does not cover the full body, but the full body harness, it includes the legs also. So what are the requirements of full body harness? We can see some of the requirement. For example, lifeline must be secure above the point of operation. Lifeline is the rope which we are going to tie it on above our body, from where we are going to connect this lanyard. We call it lanyard. Lanyard is going to connect with the lifeline. So the lifeline must support 5,400 pounds of dead weight. Lifeline must be 3x4 inch for most operation. Lanyard must be half inch for, and it should be made up of a nylon or equivalent. Lanyard must not allow a fall over 6 feet, because if your lanyard, which is connected to the lifeline, this is also a rope type, belt type. So if it is connected with a lanyard and you are going to fall on a very depth, so it might be possible that it will impact on your arms, on your shoulders, and also on your thighs, because you are going to fall. If you are going to fall from height, and so there will be a jerk on your body. So that's why too much, the size of your lanyard should not be more than 6 feet, because the more size, which means the more jerk you are going to have. For example, if here you are hanging your lifeline and lanyard, and if here it's okay, but if you are going to fall here, which means more jerk on your body. So that's why it should not be more than 6 feet. So lanyard breaking height strength is 5,400 pounds. Hardware, we call it hardware. These are all hardware. It must be made up of metal or pressed steel or cadmium. And hardware must be smooth and free of sharp edges, so it will remain comfortable for the people who are going to use. One thing which is very important, that all the lifting equipment and the lifting PPEs, for example, this full body harness, as required by OSHA, it will be inspected on annual basis, right? You are going to inspect them on annual basis minimum. And the date shall also be mentioned here, when is the last inspection made, because with the passage of time, the quality of this lanyard is going to be deteriorated. It's going to be reduced. So we need to make sure that whatever full body harness we are going to use, it's inspected and up to the mark. Yes, guys, any question?
Yes, sir.
Clear?
Clear. Yes.
Good. Let me show you the video about PPE.
Sir, I have one question.
Yes, please.
Yeah, this lanyard you're talking about, it's a nylon strap, right?
No, nylon or similarly.
Something, so that will be connected to the nylon strip.
Lifeline.
Right.
Okay, after the, on the lanyard, at the corner, there is a hook, right? There's a clip, which is going to be connected. It's not like you are going to tie it.
Okay, okay.
Majre?
It's a money.
Good, good, good. Can you see the screen? Can you see the screen or no?
Yeah, I can see the screen.
Yeah, we can.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Then why you are silent?
Silence.
And what about
you.
Voice?
Music. Yeah.
Okay. We'll be right back. Have you seen the importance of PPE?
Yes, very important.
So what do you think now? PPE is still a control, or is you agree with me? So PPE is a control or not a control?
Not a control. So products sometime.
Yes, PPE is very necessary, but my point is, don't rely only on the PPEs. Okay. Okay, can you see the screen? Shall we start with our next topic?
Yes, sir.
So our next topic is about basic electricity safety. We are going to discuss what are the precautions we need to take out when we are dealing with the electricity. Actually, this should come before the PPE, but since some of the guys were late, so that's why I started PPE, because PPE, many of you already know much about the PPE, so we started with the PPE. Otherwise, as per sequence, we should start with electricity. Anyway, let's start with electricity. Electricity is the movement of electrons. Electrons are going from one place to another in a very fast speed. So the more fast speed, which means we have more. When we have more fast speed, which means we have more voltage. Volt, we need to understand some basic terminologies, then we will move forward. Volt is a measure of electrical force that seems to push the current. Okay, it's a force which is going to push the current. Similarly, ampere is the magnitude. How many electrons are available? This is our current. The volt unit is, volt is the we are going to represent volt as V, and for the current we are going to use ampere. Current is the unit of current is ampere. So what is the quantity or the magnitude or the amount of current is available, we call it ampere. Then we have Ohm law. Ohm was a scientist who developed this law, which is V is equal to IR, right? If the current is directly proportional to voltage, keeping the resistance constant. So Ohm, when we are going to think Ohm is resistance. The unit for resistance is the Ohm. And what is resistance? Resistance is basically a hindrance, or which is a force which is going to push back when the electrical current, they want to move. So that's why its unit is, we call it resistance, because it is the resistance in moving of electron, and its unit is Ohm. GFCI. What is GFCI? GFCI is the ground fault circuit interrupter. GFCI, ground fault circuit interrupter. It's a simple circuit device, or it's a simple circuit which is going to protect us from any grounding problem. For example, the current which is going in and the current which is going out, it must be equivalent. If there is a difference between the current which is going in and the current which is coming out, then this GFCI device is going to be activate. And this GFCI device purpose is to protect the equipment, is to protect the device, is to protect our machine. This GFCI device is not meant to protect the human, right? So this GFCI, it acts very fast. You can see that it acts in 1:40 speed of a second. It reacts very fast. For example, when we turn on the light, we can see that the electrons, they move very fast. And before we are going to start anything, we have the electricity available. We have the lights are turning on. So similarly, when we are turning off the light, they are reacting very fast. So similarly, when GFCI is going to interrupt, when the GFCI is going to activate, it activate with a speed of 40 times in 1 second, right? We will discuss more about GFCI. So this is a simple, you can see that how the electricity is moving, the more voltage, which means the more pressure, and the larger the dia, which means the less resistance. Is any of the pipe or any of the cable we have, different diameters of cable are available. So the more larger the dial, the less resistance. So the current can move easily. Current is like your, water, which is flowing through the pipes, hose pipe. So the flow rate of the current, for example, how much it is going to flow, like the water, which is going to flow in 1 minute or in 1 hour. Similarly, we have the current that which is going to flow from the pipes. So just to have the understanding that how electricity is moving, this is a simple example about garden hose. Now, electricity has three main types of hazard. Electricity has three main hazards. The first hazard we all know that very common is the electrical shock. Then the second hazard is electrical burns. And the third hazard is internal injuries. So whenever electricity is entering in our body, or since human body is also a good conductor of electricity, electricity is moving in his path. But once our body become contact of this path, the electricity, it comes into our body. But the problem is that we know that from where the electricity has come in our body, maybe it will be, as I told you, many of the injuries are due to our hands. Maybe we have touched some naked wiring or electrical socket, we came in contact, or we are dealing with electricity, we are an electrician or electrical engineer, we are working with the panel. So we know that electricity will be coming into our body most of the time from our hands. But from where it is going to take out, we don't know, right? The path which electricity is going to take in our body, we don't know. Electricity is going to move and finally it will go into the ground. That's why whenever we are, standing position, the electricity is going to go out from our, most of the time, from our feet. But it is not necessary from, maybe it comes from one hand and it goes out from the other hand. It comes from the top and it goes to the bottom. So maybe it comes from right side and it goes to out from the left side. So we don't know which path of electricity is going to take to, whenever it will find the more conductive area, it will go, right? Whenever it will find more conductive area in our body or outside our body, it will go there. So many of the areas in our body which can cause you the more electrical, although our body is also electrical conductor, but at the same time, if we are using the chains, if we are using the this our belts, buckles, these our rings, earrings, so these kind of jewelries are causing more chances that we will get the electricity. And our bones are not a very good conductor of electricity. They are a good resistance. So, for example, our knees, our toes, they have very strong bones. So that's why the electricity, when it came here, it get lost from our body most of the time. So the first thing, that it will be entering from one path and it will be going out from another path. It will be entering from one path, but we don't know which path it is going to take to go out. So electricity will always be moving from high conductor, from one conductor to another conductor. So if wherever it will find a resistance in your body, so it will be moving towards the area where there is more conductance available. Clear? Any mushkil?
Clear.
Maafi mushkil.
Maafi mushkil. Good. So this, we are just going to give you a very brief about electricity. Otherwise, we have some participants. I think Murtuza is electrical engineer. And another, I think we have one more guy having the background of electrical. So we can ask them to discuss the technical points of electricity. Anyway, we also have the course available for electrical safety. The thing is, the severity of electrical shock, it depends on the voltage. The higher the voltage, the greater the current, because these are directly proportional to each other. Duration, the length of time that a person is being exposed. The more time the person is going to expose, which means the more amount of electrons are going to transfer in his body. the current path, as I told you, if it is going to enter from one hand and it is going to take the path, it will be roaming around in our body and it will go out from our foot, then which means that if the path is very long and wherever this electricity is going to move in our body, we will be affecting, these parts will be affecting. Frequency of the AC current, then we have resistance. If we have skin condition, depending on the skin condition and the clothing, if we have dry skin, which means the more chances of current. And similarly, if our skin is damp or wet, then again the chances of electrical shock are more. Contact surface area, that how much time, the more skin in contact, the more severe the injury. And environmental factor, for example, metal surface, humidity. So there are number of factors available which can cause the severity of electrical shock. Okay guys, so how electricity affects our body? For example, if the current is like 0.001 ampere, so what will be our reaction? Perception level, do you have idea? Sometimes if you have a small battery which is coming out from your watch and you are going to touch the tongue, you will feel something. Did you check it? When I was a child, this was my one of my habit, to enjoy this kind of current. Any of you have idea about this? When you are going to touch,
you're saying small acidic taste.
Yeah, yes. So this is called perception level. Only a faint tingle. I mean, very slight you are going to have. As I told you, sometimes we enjoy this amount of current. Then if the current ampere is like 0.005, then slight shock, not painful but disturbing. Have you seen that your hands are wet and you are going to touch the electrical socket or electrical button to turn off or turn on, you will get something. Have you feel in your life this kind of experience, especially sometimes in our washrooms? Yeah, in washrooms, in kitchen, where the insulation is improper, we feel this. And we get slight shock, but alhamdulillah, I mean, it's not a big thing, so we ignore it. We don't work on safety, right? Then we have 0.006 to 0.025, painful shock. This is for women, because women have more mass in their bodies. So even the 0.006 up to 0.025, it will cause them painful shock or muscular control is lost. Then in men, 0.009 to 0.030, this is called freezing current or lead gorage, which means that now you are going to feel the electrical shock. Maybe you will get displaced, maybe you will get severe shock, but this amount of current which is entering in your body, it will cause you the something which is painful. Then we have 0.05 up to 0.015, extreme pain, respiratory arrest, severe muscular contractions. So this is a very high range where our body can have effect. And at the same time, when we have 0.05 up to 0.01, our body can also get burned. Our body can also get internal injuries. And internal injuries, they cannot be appearing directly, but they are going to appear after some time, and we feel that we have got the electrical shock. Then 1 to 4.3 is ventricular fibrillation, where maybe you can have the cardiac arrest, maybe your veins are going to be disturbed. I used to go in one of the hospital, which is burn center, and when you are going to see the situation of patient, I mean, if your body is more than 33% is burned, then there is very less chance to get survive. So may Allah protect us, all of us, from any kind of burning. So up to the 10 ohm, you will get die. Okay, even up to 1 ohm, up to 5 ohm, you can get up to 5 ampere, sorry. There is a chance that you can have a very severe shock, and it might be possible that if your body is not be able to survive, then you can die very easily. Then we have next hazard about the electricity is the burns. As I told you, electrical burn can cause you tissue damages and the result of heat generated by the flow of electrical current. Electrical burns are one of the most serious injuries you can receive and need to receive immediate medical attention. Sometimes the electrical burns are possible when we have the sockets or when we have the cables which are overloaded, so they are going to start burning. For example, we have one extension wire, or we are having one socket and then we have multiple connector in it, and we are using the mobile phone charger, we are using the grinding machine, we are using some other kind of equipment with the normal this 220 volt. So this become very dangerous, and the pressure will come on these electrical socket, and after some time you will find that maybe it is going to be burned, or maybe if you have a good breaker system available, then this breaker is going to be activate. So the electricity is going to be disconnected. So electrical burns are severe, and this can cause, as I told you, burning also, and also sometimes this is very, sometimes we also get the skin problems due to this burn, even if it is a small burn. So this is a very dangerous situation. We need to protect ourselves by electrical burns, and then we have internal injuries. Internal injuries are, as I told you, that we will get the electrical shock, but physically there is no burning, there is no physically injuries on our body or on the victim body, but there are internal injuries that it might be possible that he or whoever has got the internal injuries, he will be saying that I am okay, no problem for me, it's okay for me. But with the passage of time, sometimes after 20 minutes, sometimes after 30, 40 minutes, these internal injuries are going to have their effect. So the person will go in the situation of shock, right? When the internal injuries are going to be arise, the person will go in the situation of shock. His lips will get pale. His body will get too much sweating. So from there, you can get the idea that this person is having now the internal injuries. So internal injuries is highly recommended that whenever we have the internal injuries, do not allow the victim or the casualty to sleep, because if he is going to sleep, it might be possible that he will remain asleep and he will die. So internal injuries are one of the effect of electrical shock. So we have discussed electrical shock, electrical burns, and internal injuries. Now GFCI. As I told you, GFCI is the ground fault circuit interrupter. When, if you see the inside and outside, if you see that if the 2 ampere is going, right, and similarly, if 1.95 ampere is coming, so this sensor is going to be activated. And this one is going to have the disconnection between this electrical equipment and the device and this socket. Have you seen, most of the time we find it in the industries, GFCIs. Sometimes you will also find in the hotels. These are being very less used in our homes. In our homes, we are mostly the normal one, or for air conditioner, we have some more circuit breaker. But these kind of GFCI, we don't have in our homes. So this GFCI, whenever there is a difference between in going in current and going out current, this GFCI is going to be activated, and this will be, see, this is the button which is going to be activated, and it breaks the contact between this electrical equipment and the electricity. So always remember that GFCI is not a measuring device. The purpose for GFCI is not to give you the how much is the current or how much is the ampere. The GFCI is a normal circuit breaker which is going to save your electrical equipment. And as I told you earlier, that even this GFCI purpose is not to save human. The purpose of GFCI is to save the equipment. Any question?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So what we need to do now? We need to do grounding. So when we are having the grounding, all our power supply system, electrical circuits and electrical equipment, so they are going to be protected. Whenever there is any leakage of the current, then this will be going into the grounding. Have you seen in your homes also, there are the main panel which is in your building is available. There are positive and then there is negative and there is also a neutral. So this neutral is basically is going to the ground. We have the grounding system available. Sometimes in our homes, now as required by Saudi Electricity SASO standard, there are three pin. So in these three pin, one is the negative, positive, and the one which is on the top is the neutral. So which is basically the grounding. Similarly, those all the electrical equipments or the devices which are coming nowadays, they have the three pins to make it more safer for the consumer. So we need to have the double insulated tools available when we are dealing with industrial safety. Ground all is exposed metal parts of the equipment, so there is no chance for electrical current leakage and you will get the electrical shock. When you are dealing with the power lines, locate power lines in your work area before you start the work. Prior to digging, call to have utility services. There is a very good system by Saudi Electricity that whenever they have the wiring available, the cables which are buried cable, they are going from the ground. So before 1 feet above these cables, they have the yellow and black warning sign. So if someone is going to excavate and he doesn't know that there is a cable going on from the below of this area, so 1 feet before they have the yellow and black tape which shows that there is a electrical cable passing from this area, so which is a very good control. Otherwise it might be possible during the excavation or during the digging, the persons when they are using the sharp like shovel, they are using the cranes, so it can hit the electrical cable and then there will be electrical shock and also the loss of electricity. So this is a very good control. That's why it is recommended as required by OSHA, whenever you are going to have that digging activity, you need to call the utility companies, you need to ask them, you need to make sure that there is no such utility lines available wherever you are going to make the excavation or digging. If uncertain, then keep yourself an object at least 20 feet. If you don't know how much is the power of this cable, then by thumb rule, keep yourself and objects 20 feet away from all uninsulated energized line, right? If these are not insulated, then keep away yourself and your tools at least 20 feet. If it is between 50 and 350 kV, then 10 feet is enough. And if it is more than 350, then we need to keep 50 feet difference. Have power lines de-energized and grounded prior to beginning of work. And if you are using the ladders, always use the non-conductive ladders to avoid any kind of electrical contact. Emergency contact, whenever there is an emergency of electrical shock, do not touch the casualty. This is the first rule. You need to make sure that you are safe and you need to try to save him or her, whoever is the casualty. So don't touch it, call for the help, isolate, turn off from the main panel, call for the ambulance, check the breathing. If the breathing is not the normal or if there is no such breathing, start CPR. If CPR, even if CPR is not effective, then start your AED, automatic external defibrillation, by providing the electrical shock. So then treat the burns, treat for physical shock, and ensure that the medical help is obtained. It might be possible that you are not a first aider, you don't know how to treat. So you will just stop here. You will just stop here by making the electrical. If you see your first aid box, there will be some wire gauze available, which is being used for the burning. There will be some absorbents which are especially for the burning purpose. So you will apply these absorbent, and then you will send the victim to the hospital so they can treat them. If the ambulance will come, you will hand it over them to the ambulance so they can treat those paramedical staff. They can treat them in much better way rather than you are going to take the risk. These are some of the numbers. Now we have in Jeddah region, for example, Jeddah Makkah region, we have 911. But I have seen that in some other region, still they have different numbers. In Jeddah Makkah region, we have 911. So when you are going to call 911, they are going to ask you, okay, do you want ambulance? Do you want the file madni? Do you want, police? So then you have to press relevant number. What we are going to check when we are doing the electrical safety inspection, we need to check the damage to cable sheet. For example, this one, damage to plug, flex fully insulated, no kinks or splint, no cracks should be available on the inadequate joints. For example, these kind of joints, from here we have seen most of the time that these kind of joints are incorrect. They are very loose, which are going to cause the electrical shock. Unsecured sheet, wet or contaminated, damage to the casing of equipment, burns and scotch marks. Then if you are a competent person, for example, you are a qualified electrician or you are a qualified engineer who is authorized to do the inspection of electrical installation, then what can we do? We can take out and we can make the inspection by, we need to check the fuse, we need to check the plug, we need to check the cord grip, right? Neutral, positive, negative, and then this one is the neutral. We need to check the terminals if these are secure. We need to check the fuse if it is fixed. So these are being done by the competent person. Everyone should not do this. We can do the physical inspection, or we can see physically only. We can do this only. Any question?
No, sir.
So what is the minimum distance between we need to maintain between the scaffold and energized power line?
20 feet.
Very good. Because we don't know what is the capacity. So by thumb rule, 20 feet. What is GFCI? GFCI stands for?
Ground fault circuit interrupter.
Very good. Very good. Excellent. GFCI are used to measure the capacity of electrical shock in case of short circuit. True or false?
False, sir.
False, because it's a short is the circuit, not the device, to measure the quantity of current or the resistance or the voltage, right? Yeah, let's have 10 minutes break for Salah and then we will continue.
Okay, sir.
ਹੈਲੋ ਅਸਲਾਮ ਵਾਲੇਕੁਮ ਮੈਂ ਤੇ ਆਪ ਸਰਕਾਰ ਹੈ ਹੁਣ ਪਹੁੰਚਿਆਗਾ ਪੌਣੇ 7 ਵਜੇ ਘਰ ਪਹੁੰਚਿਆ ਮੈਂ ਵੀ ਆ ਗਿਆ
ਹੈਲੋ ਹਾਂਜੀ ਸਰ Thank you.
ਸੁਬਾਨਲਾ ਕੀ ਦਾ ਮਾਮਾ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਦੁਪਹਿਰੀ ਜੱਜ ਖਾਧਾ ਇਹਨੇ ਨਾ ਵੱਡਾ ਸੀ
Yes, guys, available?
Available.
Okay, yes. Let's have this video and then we will continue. These type of videos are very popular and you will find their videos almost on all safety topics. You should subscribe their channel, napofilm.com, .net, and also on YouTube they have the channel available, and it's very very old. They are working like last 15 years. So almost on every topic of safety you will find their videos, and they are very interesting, and in a very simple way they are going to guide things.
Oh,
This is our last scenario because it's a very long video. You all know that.
You can complete the video. It's nice.
No problem. I'll share with you.
Okay, let's start with our next topic. Yes, Sajjad, any question?
Thank you, sir.
Our next topic is HSCOM. What is HSCOM?
Hazard communications.
Very good. HSCOM stands for hazard communication. HSCOM mainly deals with hazardous substances. Remember, we discussed hazard identification, risk assessment, but this is not the same thing. HSCOM is dealing with the hazardous communication, which is one of the standard from OSHA, which is HCS standard. This standard mainly deals with the hazardous substances, for example, chemicals, lubricant, used oil, welding, cutting, disc, anything which is hazardous to our health, we call it hazardous, right? And when we talk about material, so it's a very long list for the material. But most of the time, this HSCOM, we are dealing with the chemicals. Okay, we are, although this HSCOM is for all the hazardous material, but mainly it is focusing on the chemicals, hazardous chemicals. Right? This standard requires, HCS standard requires that there are certain responsibility of employees. There is certain responsibility of the manufacturer of the chemical or hazardous material. There are certain responsibilities of that person or that party who is going to import it, for example, your supplier. And there are certain responsibilities which are for the employer when they are going to purchase it. Definitely, when you are going to purchase any chemical, you are going to purchase it from some supplier. You will not go directly to the SABIC and ask them that I need 1 kilo Clorox, right? You will get it from some store or from some supplier. So they are the one who are going to make the
interim storage, sometimes the companies, they say that contact our authorized agent in your area and then you can get it, right? So those companies who are manufacturing the chemicals or the hazardous substance, there are certain responsibilities for them. What are their responsibilities? That whenever they are going to manufacture the chemical, they need to develop MSDS and they need to develop the label. This MSDS, we are going to discuss in detail in our next slides. MSDS in general are the all safety cautions which we are going to take when we are handling with this chemical. Label is the main information providing by the supplier or providing by the manufacturer, which we are going to use for certain purposes, that what is the, you know, danger, what is the pictogram, what to do in case of any injury. Just a very simple summary about. So this is called our label. So as required by OSHA standard, there are certain responsibilities of supplier, right? Manufacturer. And then when the importer, he is going to purchase the chemical and he is going to keep in his facility and then he is going to hand it over to you, then it is his responsibility to provide you the MSDS and the label, right? He is going to provide you MSDS and the label. And when it comes in your facility, for example, you are an employer, right? When it comes to the employer facility, employer has mainly three responsibilities. What are these responsibilities? The four responsibilities. What are these four responsibilities? First thing is to maintain, again, the MSDS. We need to ask our supplier, we need to ask our vendor that please provide the MSDS of this chemical or the hazardous material. We need to have available the label of the chemical, which is going to give us the information about the chemical. We need to have a hazard communication program. This is the program which will be developed by us. It will not be provided by the supplier, because maybe the supplier or the manufacturer, he is going to provide you one chemical, but in your company, in your industry, you have more than 50 chemicals you are going to use. If you go in a small laboratory, normally chemical laboratory contains more than 100 chemicals. So you are the one as an employer that who is going to develop the hazard communication program. Hazard communication program is a very simple program, again, which is going to give us the guidelines about the hazards. It is going to show us that which of the chemicals are compatible with each other and which of the chemicals are incompatible with each other. You can write one homework, just write on the Google chemical compatibility chart. Okay, chemical compatibility chart. You will find many kind of these charts. The purpose for all kind of chemical compatibility chart is same, that it is going to guide us that which of the chemicals are compatible with each other. For example, acid and base, you cannot keep together. For example, some chemicals which are sensitive to moisture, you cannot keep them with those chemicals which are not sensitive to the moisture. Some of the chemicals, for example, iodine and all the metallic metals which are available in this table, we need to keep them in the dark room and to avoid the sunlight, to avoid the normal light. So different chemicals have different reactions. Different chemicals have different properties. So according to their property, according to their nature of the chemical, according to their classification, we need to maintain this chemical in order to avoid any kind of accident. After having hazard communication program, what we need to do, the fourth thing we need to do is to provide the information and training to our staff, because to have the MSDS available, it's not enough until unless they know that what is written in this MSDS, how to react in case if there is any spill on the ground, if there is any spill on their body, if the chemical goes into their eyes, if the chemical is going to touch their skin, how to react in these things, how to discard this chemical, how to use this chemical. We need to provide them training about the safe usage of chemical, safe handling of chemicals, and similarly, how to avoid the spillage or how to manage the spill. So these are some of the training. These are some of the information as required by OSHA. We need to provide our those staff who are involved in the hazardous material handling. Clear? Any question?
Thank you, sir.
Yes,
sir. Good. There are different forms of hazardous substances. For example, it could be in the form of dust, it could be in the form of powder, it could be in the form of liquid, solid, gas, it could be in the form of mist, which is thick vapors, like it could be in the form of which is very hazardous. Just a minute.
Sulfur?
No. Which is in the construction. On the construction, the cement, we use it. Fiber. It could be in the form of fiber. See, the fiber is more lighter than dust. The particle size of fiber is more lighter than dust. Fiber is a very dangerous chemical because when it goes into our body, it directly attack on lungs. In our body, from the, you know, the natural, we have the natural filter available in our nose. Our nasal system contains a natural filter, which is what?
Hairs.
Hairs, very good. Which are the hairs in our nose? These are our natural filter. But this natural filter can stop up to 5 micron. If the particle size, whenever we have 5 micron or above particle size, when it goes in our nose, what is going to be happen? We get a sneeze, achy, and khalas, the filter is clear. So now when we have the fiber, this fiber is less than 5 micron. So we need to use the mask, right? Similarly, when we have those particles, those bacteria, those viruses which have less than 5 micron, that's why for the corona also we are going to use the mask, because it is less than 5 micron and it can enter in our body very easily. So we are going, this fiber is very dangerous because in many countries it is banned, right? In many countries, it is banned. We have the due to the problem of the cancer. Many of the countries, they have made its usage as banned, right? One of the things which is very necessary to know about that. About the fiber, that you will find them on the construction. When the buildings are getting demolished, you will find the fibers, right? And on construction site, in cement, we find some traces. And it's very, I used to go to some cement companies, although it was a very good company. I went to Ghana, Africa, for their audit. It was a very good company, German company. They were Ghasim. The name was Ghasim, Ghana Cement. So they were manufacturing the cement, and I went there twice. The system for adding this carcinogenic material, it was very much controlled. They were using the filter mask, but the problem, when I discussed with them in detail, they told that if this fiber is in the form of dust, then it is problematic. But when it becomes solid, for example, we have asbestos. The asbestos is the material basically which is the fiber, right? Asbestos, it comes in the form of fiber, which is a very light particle. So asbestos, when they are using the asbestos in their component, most of the operations were automatic. But sometimes those companies which they don't have the system automatic, they are using the asbestos
as manual. They have the packs available, like 25 kilo powder packs, and they are going to add this manually, which is very dangerous for the people who are going to handle it. But it is a very excellent, or you can say it's a very solid material, very good strength. Have you seen in the villages, in the old times, we have asbestos sheets. So these asbestos sheets, still if you go to the remote areas, the village areas, you will find asbestos, the homes which are having asbestos sheets as their roof. Similarly, warehouses, they have asbestos sheets available, because these asbestos sheets are very good against weather condition. If it is a rain, if it is a high heat, they are going to protect. So this asbestos sheet, if it is, you know, if it is spread, now forget about 20, 25 years, nothing is going to be happen. But when this asbestos sheet start cracking, it becomes very difficult for the human, because the particles are very light. You cannot see from the naked eyes. And the effect is, if you are in contact for long time, it has a chronic effect. It is not going to affect in 1 day, 2 days, when you are working in this area where there are some fiber, there are some asbestos particles are available, then you will get, you know, lungs cancer. So it's very dangerous. In UK, it's banned. In America, it's not fully banned, because, you know, America is the largest producer of asbestos. So it's all commercials. But anyway, as far as my study chemical is concerned, there are blue asbestos and there are white asbestos. So blue asbestos is more dangerous than white asbestos. So if in the products, they are using the white asbestos, which means it's much safer as compared to the blue asbestos. But for sure, asbestos is dangerous for our health, right? This is just the information I thought provided to you, because some of you are working in the construction site, that especially, as I told you, construction itself is not much harmful, but the demolishing activity where the dust is going to be evolved, it's a very dangerous. For example, you have an old building and you want to demolish it by means of cranes or by means of manual or by means of any bomb. So it is going to produce too much asbestos, so which is very dangerous for human health. Now we need to understand routes of entry. Definitely, when we know that it's a hazardous material, we need to avoid its contact as much as possible. So from where it can enter in our body, these are the routes of entry. There are four routes of entry, possibilities. There are four possibilities from where a material can enter into our body. Number one is the ingestion. Ingestion means that you have eating something, you have drinking something. For example, you have eating something which is a rotten food, right? So you will get food poisoning, right? Sometime you are drinking something which is not good for your health, you will get poisoned, you will get infected. So ingestion is one of the way, by means of mouth, we are going to take something in our body. Then we have inhalation. Definitely, for example, dust, for example, smell, for example, gases, they are going into our body by means of inhalation. For example, ammonia gas, very dangerous. H2S gas, very dangerous gas. Iodine gas, very dangerous gas. So these are entering in our body by means of inhalation. So it can affect on our body. Sometimes the effect is, you know, chronic, and sometimes the effect is very quick effect. Then we have absorption. Absorption, that it is not going through our mouth or through our nose, but these are entering in our body through our eyes or other membranes. For example, if the chemical is going to spill in your eyes, or if the chemical it goes into your skin through your through your air. So these are going into the body by means of membrane. Then we have injection. Injection means that physical puncture, when, for example, we are getting the injection, so they are going to insert the needle in our body. So this is injection. Similarly, if you are getting cut from any sharp edges, this is also considered as injection. So since due to injection, our skin membranes are going to be damaged.
So any of the hazardous material can enter into our body, and that's why we are going to have the bandage available. That's why when you have the injury, the doctors are saying, please avoid it with water, please avoid it with other things to touch with this injury, right? So these are four routes of entry in our body from where the hazardous substances can enter into our bodies easily. Then we have very important thing, we call it safety data sheet, or in more sophisticated language, or you can say in UK, they are going to say material safety data sheet, MSDS. In USA, most of the time they are used to say SDS, but also MSDS is common. So when we are using official word, we can say that it's MSDS, but in OSHA standard, most of the time we have find that the word is they are using the word terminology as SDS. So both are same, MSDS or SDS is the same name for one document. MSDS or SDS is a document, is a formal document which is going to provide you the information about the relevant hazards which are associated with this substance which you are going to use. MSDS mainly has 16 sections, and before, in old time, every country or the every manufacturer, they used to have their own format of SDS or MSDS. So the companies who are in America, they have their own format. The companies who are in UK, in Germany, in China, they all have their own formats. But finally, then a few years ago, they sit together and they developed some basic rules for the SDS and for the label, which they call it GHS. GHS is the globally harmonized system of classification for labeling of chemicals. And they also defined that we need to have how many elements or how many sections of MSDS are necessary to be available. So our OSHA standard also follows the guidelines of GHS. So as required by our OSHA standard or GHS, we need to have 16 sections available in the MSDS. I will show the video about this, so you will get all the information about each of the section of MSDS very easily. You can see one sample of this MSDS, and then we have, if you see this colored diamond, you can say diamond because it's not the triangle. So this is something we call it NFPA diamond. What we are going to call it NFPA diamond. This color is going to indicate something. This is a very simple MSDS. Most of the time you don't find such simple MSDS in actual. Maybe your MSDS will be like 4 pages, 3 pages, where everything is written in detail. But this is just to have a, you know, idea. I took this snapshot for you guys. So this is our NFPA diamond. This is our, have you seen the Bowsers when you're going on a highway, they have this kind of sign available on their back. How many of you have seen? You will find, for example, they are taking the benzene from one place to another. They are having some other chemicals. You will find everywhere.
Yes, sir. I have seen in trailers which are carrying these acids and crude oil.
Exactly. Because it's also a legal requirement here in the kingdom. It's also a legal requirement that they need to have this sign available. What does it mean? So the blue color shows the health hazard. And this numbering, if it is 0, which means the less effective, and if it is 4, is the maximum, right? So when we say health hazard, if it is 0, which means normal material, 1 slightly hazardous, 2 hazardous, 3 extreme danger, and 4 is the deadly. Then this red color shows the fire hazard. Depending on the flash point of this material, we are going to have the numbering. So in this case also, the 4 is the maximum, which means it has very less flash point and it can catch the fire very easily. Then we have yellow, which is instability, because many of the chemicals are stable. So that's why we are not taking the stability, we are taking the instability, that up to how much strength this material or this substance is instable. So again, it has the rating up to 4. It could be stable if it is 0, it's stable, unstable if heated. For example, if you are taking it into sunlight, it becomes unstable. 2 is the violent chemical change. Number 3 is shock and heat may detonate. And number, if there is a 4, which means that may detonate. And then this white color box, it remains open for any other type of hazard if it is available, if you want to mention. Otherwise, no need to mention here. So sometimes it could be an oxidizer, it could be an alkali, it could be corrosive, it could be use of no water, it could be a radiation hazard. So in this white color, we have the choice that whatever is a specific hazard, we can write it here. So it will not be in the form of numbers. It will be in the form of symbol. Right? Any question?
Clear. Clear, sir.
Good. Okay. So next thing is about the label. As I told you, that GHS has developed the guidelines for chemical labeling and also for the MSDA. So what are the requirements for label? What are the requirements for label which we are going to know? Because many of the many of the chemicals, if they are not coming with the MSDS, then how do we know that what is the impact of this chemical? Maybe we will misuse it. Maybe we are using this chemical first time, so we don't know what is the impact. So you can say a simple summary of this MSDS is available on the label of the chemical or the hazardous substance. So what are the requirements? There are six elements which are needed. Number one is the single word. For example, what is the name? You can say it's a dangerer or it's a corrosive. This is one of the requirement of a single word. Then GHS symbol, you can see what the symbol here. Then manufacturer information, who is the manufacturer information, you can see here, right? And then precautionary statements, what you need to do, what are the precautions you are going to take. Hazard statements, you can see this is the hazard statement. Highly flammable liquid and vapor causes serious eye damage, may cause rosiness and dizziness. So, and then the product name or the identifier. This is the product name, right? Or the chemical name or the commercial name, whatever it is. So these are six elements which are needed as required by GHS to be available in any kind of chemical label. And we should ask our supplier or we should ask our vendor to provide this label and this MSDS whenever we are going to purchase any of the chemical or hazardous substance. And if they are not going to provide you, then you can contact to the company, you can send them the email, you can call them, and then they are going to provide you the updated MSDS. Now most of the manufacturer of chemical, they have put the updated MSDS on their website. So you can just go to the supplier website and you can download it, the MSDS. Or if it is not available on their website, you can just send them the email or call them and they will send you at the same time. Right? Any question?
Yeah.
Clear. Good. Yeah, let's have the video about MSDS and label. And then there will be another video about the classification of chemicals. Can you see the screen and the voice?
Yes, sir.
Many of the chemicals we use in the lab are potentially dangerous, especially under high heat, pressure, or when they're mixed with other chemicals. There are two main tools that we use to identify chemical hazards: safety data sheets and chemical labels. Every chemical in the lab is required to have a technical document called a safety data sheet, or SDS, usually provided by the manufacturer. These were formerly known as material safety data sheets, or MSDS. The safety data sheet is a one-stop shop to find out about a chemical's properties, hazards, and safety precautions. Know the location of the safety data sheets in your lab and review them before working with a chemical for the first time. GHS is an acronym for the Globally Harmonized System of Classification and Labeling of Chemicals. This new system provides an international standard format for safety data sheets. All SDS must now be organized into 16 sections. Section 1, Identification. Here you'll find the chemical's name, description, and the manufacturer's contact information. 2. Hazard identification. This section lists signal words, warnings, and safety symbols. 3. Composition, a list of ingredients. 4. First aid measures. What's the required treatment for a person who's been exposed? 5. Firefighting measures. 6. Accidental release measures. These are instructions for containment and cleanup of spills or leaks. 7. Handling and storage requirements. 8. Exposure controls and personal protection. This describes OSHA's exposure limits and recommendations for PPE. 9. Physical and chemical properties, such as appearance, odor, pH, flash point, solubility, and evaporation rate. 10. Stability and reactivity, how to avoid hazardous reactions. 11. Toxicological information, find out about the likely routes of exposure symptoms as well as short and long-term effects. Sections 12 through 16 aren't mandatory, but you should at least be familiar with them. Ecological, disposal, transport, and regulatory considerations. Section 16 is for any other pertinent information. This is where you'll find the date that the SDS was prepared along with the last known revision. Safety data sheets provide a lot of information about how to use chemicals safely in the lab. But there's also another way to learn about a chemical, and that's by reading its label. The new GHS format requires each chemical in the lab to be labeled with the product name, a signal word, such as danger or caution, physical, health and environmental hazard statements, precautionary statements, pictograms, first aid instructions, and the supplier's contact information. Pictograms consist of a symbol on a white background, framed in a red border. Each pictogram represents a specific hazard. Health, flammability, toxicity, compressed gases, skin and eye protection, unstable explosives, oxidizers. An oxidizer is a chemical that initiates combustion through the release of oxygen. Environmental hazards, and acute toxicity. Now you know how to identify potential chemical hazards by looking at both safety data sheets and chemical labels. In our next lesson...
Okay, guys, any question about MSDS? Yes, guys, any question about MSDS?
Thank you, sir.
No, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, let's discuss the classification of chemicals by NAPO. So it will not be a boring, it's a long video, but inshallah you will not get bored. But please watch this video not for the entertainment, but to learn something, because we will be using these things in our upcoming slides, in our upcoming modules, right? So take it serious.
Okay.
Can you see the screen?
Yeah, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, guys, clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, clear.
Okay, shall we take a 10-minute break and then we'll continue? Okay, or you want to continue?
No, break, break, break.
We want to continue, so we can finish our...
Oh, yeah, we can do this.
No, no, we will take the break because it will make more exhaust. The next topic, I don't want to interrupt in between.
Okay, sir, no problem.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, guys, available?
Yes, I am.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Good. So our next topic is about material storage and powertrain. In this topic, we are going to discuss few things about manual handling, what are the precautions. Then we will discuss about some precautions about the power trucks, for example, forklifts, and then also the crane, right? So let's start. Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. So what are the hazards of manual handling? You know, what is manual handling? Any idea about manual handling, Khalid?
Yes. Move the things from the
lifting with hands.
Very yes. Good. Lifting with hands, heavy lifting.
Back up with hands.
Exactly, lifting with hands. And not only lifting, but it also includes pushing, pulling. So wherever we are going to apply the force, it comes under the category of manual handling. If it is more than 50 pounds for men and more than 25 pounds for women. Okay. So manual handling is a very hazardous activity, but in our companies, we are doing it on regular basis. If you go to the fertilizer plant, if you go to the cement plant, if you go to different kind of companies, I used to go there time to time. So I have seen that the whole process of cement or fertilizer manufacturing, it's automatic. But when it comes to the position where they have to put the bags into the trucks, it's still a manual handling. So sometimes if we are not using the pallets in the trucks, then we have seen that the workers, they are keeping these cement bags or fertilizer bags by means of manual handling. So this manual handling can cause you starting from fractures and bruises, and it can goes up to the cuts and bruises, wounds. And this is something, sometimes you are going to have the acute effect, the very quick effect of it. And sometimes you are going to have the chronic effect. When we have acute effect, for example, sometimes you are lifting heavy and you will get backache, right? Sometimes your muscles are going to be pulled. So this is a part of our, most of the hazards which are associated with the manual handling are health relevant. Remember we discussed on first day that some of the hazards are health focusing and some of the hazards are injury focusing. So manual handling hazards, most of the time they are health relevant because we cannot see them physically. They are not causing you to be bleeding most of the time unless it's cuts and bruises. So you are going to have severe health effect if you are involved in the manual handling on regular basis. So what are the precautions we need to carry out when we are going to have the manual handling? The first thing which is very important and very necessary to have the manual handling plan available. When we talk about plan, it's not the documented plan. Sometime when we have the lifting available with, when we are doing the lifting with the cranes, then in this case, we need to have the lifting plan available for the crane lifting. But when it's a manual handling, there is no need to have the documented plan available, but this plan will be in our mind. Keeping the consideration of, for example, what is the size of load, where I have to take the load, what is the volume of the load. Sometimes the load is not much heavy, but the volume is very wide. So it becomes very difficult for us to handle. Where I have to go, the area where I have to go, the surface is smooth or there is a chance of trip hazard or slip hazards. The area where I have to take this load, if it involves the stairs or it's a smooth area, what about the lightning, what about the moisture, what about the overall temperature of the area. So because we are going to use it by ourselves, by our own, So we need to consider all these factors when we are going to start the manual handling. So manual handling, the main thing is to have this plan, these requirements to be very clear about manual handling. Then we are going to start the manual handling. So if you can see these pictures, the first thing what we need to have is the plan, right? He's thinking about. And then when we are going to lift something, we need to have a very strong grip. And keep in mind that your back should be straight, not the tilted, right? Sometimes when you are lifting something, your back become this kind of D shape. It's a very dangerous for your back egg. Your backbone is to have a very severe impact. Sometimes the intervertebral discs are going to be dislocated. So whenever we are going to do the manual handling, we need to have a strong grip on the load and our back should be straight. We need to sit easily. Sometimes how we are going to take out the load, when like we are going to make the ruku, we are going in salam and we are doing the ruku. So we are, our postures become like that, which is very dangerous. So we need to sit calm, close to the weight, and your back shall be straight enough. And then when you are going to uplift the load, you are going to stand with the load, right? Your whole body weight is involved on the load. So after the having the very strong grip, when you are lifting up the load, do not get any of the loose, because it might be possible when you are lifting the load, it can fall. So your grip should be very strong. And then you are carrying the load, which should be close to your body. What will happen if the load is not close to your body? Then what's going to happen? That your weight of the hands is going to involve. For example, if the load is not here, it's here. So your hands will be like that. So the weight of the load is being occupied by your hands. And after some time, you will get tired. But if the load is close to your body, then this weight of the load is being distributed to overall to your overall body, right? The effect will not only be on the hands, but it will be distributed evenly and it will be on your whole body. Whole body is involved. And if you have a tummy like me, then you can put the load on your tummy, no problem. And then you will going wherever you want to go. And when you are going to keep the load, make sure that if possible, not necessary, but if possible, you can keep the load into two steps, right? You can keep the load into two steps. That first step, just keep the load on one stage, and then from here, keep the load here. So there will be very less chance of jerk, because when we are going to keep the load on the ground, again, we need to apply the same posture, right? Sometimes what happened that since we are in very hurry, we just make it like the wrong position. It's like D shape of our body and it causes you the jerk. So this is about the manual handling. This we need to have the manual handling in our homes. What could be the equipment or the tools we are using as manual handling? Any example? Yes, guys.
Our bags.
Your bags more than 50?
No, but it is a weight.
Okay. Other examples?
Water gallon.
Very good. Water can dispenser. Very good. Gas cylinder.
Gas cylinder, yes. So gas.
This gas cylinder is also manual. Sorry?
The rice bag, if it's very big.
We have our luggage, traveling luggage, more than 25. If you are flying with Saudi Airlines, then 25 kilo is allowed. So this comes under the manual handling. So there are multiple examples. Time to time, we are dealing with it. In companies, we have sometimes the option. So our job as a safety professional is to, if wherever possible, we need to avoid the
manual handling. As a safety professional, as far as our risk assessment is concerned, we would be discouraging the manual handling activities, right? We will be suggesting that you should use the other replacement, for example, hand trolley, for example, jack trolley, for example, hydraulic trolleys, for example, forklift, for example, cranes, to lift the load from one place to another rather than the people are involved. We have seen in some companies when it becomes impossible to avoid manual handling, they are having the groups, like one person will be doing the job like 15 to 20 minutes and then 15 to 20 minutes break. The other team will be doing the same job of lifting. Then they will take the break, then another team. So they have basically for one activity, they have three teams available, especially when they have the continuous plan on continuous line or continuous plants, when the product is coming continuously, then you cannot stop it. So you have to handle it in a very minimum time. So there will be no such pile or crowd is there at the end of the product. So this is one of the control for the manual handling to reduce the time of handling. Okay, when we will be doing the risk assessment of manual handling, one of the very important control, if it is possible, we need to replace it with mechanical devices. If not possible, then we need to make the brakes. Okay, we need to have the brakes available, frequent brakes available for those who are involved in the manual handling, right?
Right.
Any questions?
Yes, yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, so for tomorrow, one homework. You will be carrying your gas cylinder and just try this manual handling. I'm not talking about female participant. I'm talking about only male participant. The female, they can use the water dispenser, right? Which is less heavy, just to check your you know how you are going to handle, if you are following all these precautions or no. Maybe you can ask some other family member or your colleague who is living with you, just to check your body posture, and if you want, you can share the video with us, no problem.
But I approve. I go to the gym.
Okay, now as I told you, the replacement we are going to do for the manual handling is to save the material, to move the to save moving of material mechanically by using of forklift, by using of our hand trolleys, by using of our hydraulic trolleys or cranes. Whenever we are the industrial trucks, forklifts are also called industrial trucks, right? When we are going to use the forklift, we need to keep the load on the center. So the gravity lies in between the forks, right? Avoid overloading. For example, if your forklift can bear up to 2 tons, 3 tons, 5 tons, do not try to keep more than this, because the forklift engine is going to have effect. The forklift tires, they are going to have effect. Sometimes we put the dead weight on behind, which is not a good practice, which is not a safe practice. So whatever the capability of our forklift is, we need to keep the same load, not more than this load. Whenever we are going to travel with the load in our forklifts, we need to keep the forks as low as possible near to the ground, because if the load will be high and if it is going to be fall, then it will be more damage rather than if the load is low, it is near to the ground. If it is going to be fall, the chances of falling will be less, and in case if it is going to be fall, so the damage will be less as compared to if it is going to be fall from more height. We need to check we need to do the inspection of forklift. It could be done on shift, start of shift basis. It could be done on 24 hours basis. So this forklift, whenever we are going to travel on the forklift, also remember there is a very important requirement which is recommended. It's not a mandatory requirement in Kingdom, but it's a recommended that for the forklift operator, we need to carry out 3 tests. By the way, in Kingdom, they have started the license from Dalla for the forklift operators, and Mudan is forcing the companies now that their forklift operators, they should take the license of forklift driving rather than
the third party training. Before, the requirement was just to have a third party training certificate or the card available for the forklift drivers. But now it's a regulation that they have to take the license of forklift driving, and which will be issued by the Dalla, like our driving license is being issued. So when we have the forklift, for the forklift driver, there are three tests internationally which are recommended. The first test is the eyesight. Definitely, the person who is driving the forklift or any of the vehicle, his eyesight should be working well and he can see near and far, he can see easily. Then we have the next test is called audiometry. Audiometry means the test for the hearing power. Right? It might be possible if the person does not have a good hearing power and he is driving the forklift and from behind or from somebody is calling him, if there is in case of emergency, there is a siren, then he will not be able to listen. So that's why hearing test or audiometry test is also necessary requirement for forklift. The third test is called epilepsy. Epilepsy is a seizure. Is a seizure, or in Urdu, we can say mirgi. Mirgi ka dora, right? So this is the situation, this seizure situation, it remains only for 2-3 minutes. But in this 2-3 minutes, the person having this problem, he will not be in her or in his senses. So for example, if the forklift driver is carrying a load and there is a problem of epilepsy, then what will happen? So all the load can get damaged and maybe there could be a very severe accident which can take his life or the lives of others. So it's very, highly recommended that we need to have the eyesight and then the hearing power, the audiometry, and then the epilepsy test available for the forklift drivers. You can see these are different types of forklift according to the requirement of your lifting material. You can use the forklift. Now let's have the discussion. We will be dividing into two groups. Take out your books. And one of the group will be discussing about precaution when operating forklift, and the other group will be discussing about the precautions while the crane is operating. I will divide you into two groups. Let me check which page number. Just open your books. Page number 53, traveling precautions. Page number 53. And then we have page number 51. Okay, what safety measures should employers take regarding crane? You will find some bullet points. There are 8 or 9 bullet points. Right, page number 51. What safety measures should employer take regarding cranes? This is one group. And the other group will be discussing page number 53. Last, traveling precautions. You will find some points here before the heading of driving on ramps and grids, only these points which are on page number 54, starting from the last line of page number 53 up to the page number 54. So just take out 5 important points like we carried out yesterday. In your own words, you can write the keywords and you will explain in your own words. The group number A, I will make the groups. So Khalid, Usama, Murtuza, Sajjad, and Sharif in one group. Okay. So your is the precautions for crane. Okay. And then in next group, we have Afra, okay, Amanat, Irtiza, Sajjad, and Saqib. So you will have the precautions for forklift. right? Yeah, let's have 10 minutes fast. We need to discuss it.
Assalamu alaikum.
Yes, guys, who is going to share the screen? Forklift, ready?
Just a sec.
Crane, ready the crane.
The host disabled the participant's screen sharing.
Oh, there's another problem. Yes, now you can share.
So, traveling precautions and best practices while traveling in a forklift includes, these are the main points that we gathered. First one is the operator's driver license should be legit and he should be medically cleared before he is hired. And some of them, they will fake their licenses up, or maybe it's expired, or maybe their medical is not cleared and they're still hired. I think it's maybe the employer's fault or they're using source, but this was a very strict rule. And the second one is he should have authorization from the management or whomever is the authority, and he should be teamed up with a flagman to guide him through the workplace or the inside of an industry or a factory. Third one is the most basic rule for traveling, that you maintain control of your forklift at all times. If he's a proper licensed driver, so of course he will take care of this, of his forklift. Do not put any part of your body between the upright of the mast or when traveling outside of the forklift frame. So basically some people, what they will do is they will poke out their legs and relax while driving with one hand, and you know, so that's a bad part. And always observe posted speed limits. That's usually 5 miles per hour. I think it will be 2 to 2.5 kilometers per hour in here. A forklift should not be driven faster than a quick walking pace. Like, shouldn't be faster than someone's walking. So keep a distance of at least 3 forklift lengths. There should be at least 3 forklifts ahead of you, and that should be the distance between 2 of them. And never allow anyone to walk or stand underneath one of the elevated forks, even if the forks are not carrying a load. Sometimes if there's a malfunction, it can just come downwards into someone's head. Or if they're not wearing safety helmet, that's also a point. You should have had that. And never engage in stunt driving or horse play. I've seen the workers playing around with the forklifts.
Excellent. Any question, guys? They have covered almost all important points. Yes, guys, any question?
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Next. Yes, precautions for pains.
The points are to instruct the workers to pad the sharp edges of the lifting load to prevent cutting of the slings. So if you have any sharp equipment, if it's lifting by the crane, the workers around the side, they should put padding so there is and cover all the sharp edges. So while lifting, there is no cutting of the sling, or there could be a safety and fall hazard. Then one of the point was to train the workers how to attach the load properly, and basically they should have proper training. And the third point, you can say, we have to teach the workers to take protective measures around the power lines. As we already mentioned, that we have to keep a distance of 20 feet, but these are power lines, so I think the distance will be much further. The fourth point is assign mechanics for periodic maintenance of the lift to avoid hydraulic system components or any type of system components leak failure. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, audible, but with your voice, it seems that you are very much tired.
No, I'm not tired. I didn't have tea.
You should take a correct chai.
Yes, chai.
Okay, TUV, what do you mean by TV, TUV?
I was as one of the one of
TUV means TUV means a third party certification.
Yes. Oh.
Rainland. Rahimland.
TUV does not mean third party certification. TUV is a name of a company which is very old in this field of inspection. So this is our wrong concept that TUV means is the third party. Third party is third party, and like TUV, there are too many companies who are operating in the kingdom and outside the kingdom to do the third party inspection. So in common words, I know those people who are working in fields, especially in Yambo area and in Jubail area, most of the time they are saying you must have TUV certificate, TUV card, blah, 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 blah. But the correct word is third party inspection. Okay. And this can be done by anyone, any authorized company.
So it means the employer should, if he's renting the equipment or buying the equipment should have a third party inspection.
Third party inspection for the crane as well as third party certificate for the driver also, operator also.
Oh, bringing the driver.
Okay, very good. Any questions, guys?
To avoid any liability issues later, then they even should have, as you said, even for the driver, for the rigger as well. Our last point was
certified rigger. Certified rigger, exactly for both. Because rigger is the one basically who is moving the operator.
Yes,
crane operator is only a dummy position. Mm-hmm. The responsibility of rigger is a very, it's a very sophisticated job. It's a very technical field. There are rigger level 1, rigger level 2, rigger level 3.
Yes.
And, sometimes when you are working on the project manager is miskeen having a small car, but that rigger who is freelance, he comes in Land Cruiser.
Yeah, but it's high
pay. And when he comes, everyone is like, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. Go out from this area, We have to start. So his time is very precious and they are charging as per hour. So any of you, if you want to earn...
Almost ended up as a rigger.
But at the end of the day, it's not a professional.
Yeah, that is one of the reasons. I remember you were talking about the crane. Means there was we had a classmate back in Riyadh. He actually died in a crane accident. Forklift.
Forklift.
He was driving a forklift and he had a very big load. But he was our age and he did not have proper license anything.
Allah.
He was just alert.
Sometimes too in companies I have seen this. This thing sometimes when the forklift operator or the forklift driver is absent, anyone from the store or warehouse, they start moving this. They think that since we have car license, so we can drive the forklift. Wallahi, this is mushkil. This is a very big violation.
Yeah, very horrible death, you can say.
Okay, let's see the video and then we will move forward. Could you please unshare your screen or I will do. Okay, good. Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
And the sound?
No sound.
You can hear it.
This music, at least, it will waking you up.
Thank you.
Yes, guys. How was the video?
Very expensive. Very expensive video.
Informative.
Very good. Because these are all real accidents. These are not animated. Okay, let's proceed with our last topic for today, which is ergonomic. What is ergonomic? Any idea? If you go to purchase the furniture, they will say our furniture is ergonomic friendly. What does it mean? If you see IKEA, Homebox, Home Center, they used to claim that their office furniture is ergonomic friendly. Any idea about ergonomic?
Like lightweight, sir.
If it will be lightweight, then the people like me, how they are going to survive?
We can say manual handling, something like this.
Not manual handling.
Comfortable,
yes, comfortable to the human need.
Designed
for human being, but if you have pets, they can also stay there, no problem. Okay, so ergonomic is nowadays the universities, they are offering PhD in ergonomics, but at the same time in industries, still in our region, we are not focusing on this activity. We do focus on, as I told you, on safety, injury, but we don't focus on health side. So ergonomic is all about health side, right? Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
So ergonomic is a way of designing workstation, work practice, and workflow. It consists of three things, right? The elements are three. The design of our workstation, how my workstation is designed, how are my work practices, and what I'm going to do. These all three factors are going to make the ergonomics. Ergonomic design reduces risk factors known to contribute the occupational ergonomic injuries and ill health, such as sprains, strain, and cumulative trauma disorder, CTD. So if we are having the problems in our workstation, what is workstation?
Where we work.
Your desk.
Your desk place. Or wherever you are going to perform your activity. Sometimes you are having a computer on your desk, on your workstation, but sometimes you are doing another job. So it might be possible there is no workstation and there is no computer, but this will be considered as your workstation or workplace. So where you are going to perform the job, where you are spending the more time you are spending in the during your work, right? So the design of your workstation and how you are going to perform your activities, your practices, and the workflow to accommodate the capabilities. It might be possible that the person who is involved in the like in our previous topic, the person who is going to involve in the manual handling, he does not have the capability to do this activity. So it can affect arises the ergonomic issues. If the work is performed in awkward posture or with excessive effort, fatigue and discomfort may result. For example, this person, when we are working on workstation with our computers, the screen and our eyes shall be in a straight line, right? There should be an angle of 180 degrees. So there will be no issues with our neck, but like he is working the same way before, I was also used to do work for too much time I used to spend all the time on my laptop. But if our postures are incorrect, if my seating arrangement is incorrect, for example, when you are taking this training, if you are sitting on your bed, you cannot be, you cannot be comfortable for a long time. You will get the laziness. You will get the drowsiness, right? So why? Because we are already tired and we are sitting on the bed and in front of air conditioner. So definitely our postures are incorrect. Our neck, we can have the problem in our neck egg, like I had before, when your screen and your face is not in the same direction or not on the same angle. So you will have the problems. And this is not only with your screen, but also when you are doing, for example, the task frequently, repeatedly task. For example, if you are a conveyor operator or you are a staff who is involved in the packaging activities, we have seen that. For example, I used to go in cigarette manufacturing companies, PMI, Philip Morris, a very good company, although. But when the cigarette comes, it's like in 1 minute they have more than 60 cigarettes. And sometimes when they have the latest machine, it can produce up to 300 cigarettes. So when these cigarettes come, then they are going to get primary packaging automatically. But when this packs of 20 cigarettes, they are coming with very fast speed. So on the conveyor, they have 8 to 10 people teams who are going to put those packages onto the big pack to make the full large pack, right? In our local language, we call it danda, right? So this kind of activities which are repeated. For example, I used to go in, still I'm we have some clients, pharmaceutical, where they are making the tablets. So you know that the tablets is also a very fast production, and in 1 minute sometimes it's 400 tablets, sometimes 500 tablets are coming, and then they get stripped, and after the stripping they have to put these strips into the packs. So for example, if you are going to take the Panadol pack, so there will be, I think, 2 strips or 3 strips inside one pack. So when these strips are coming very fast, then there is a team of you know, labor who are involved in just putting these strips into the pack. So as far as the contact, the body contact is concerned, they are not going to have any contact with the cigarette or with the medicine. But in the primary packaging, then when they are going to make into the secondary packaging, it's most of the time a manual handling. So this repetitive task, or sometimes they have to keep them into the trolleys or into the other cartons. So these kind of activities where the postures are incorrect, where the position is awkward, where there is a repetitive task, then our muscles, tendons, ligaments, nerves, and blood vessels can be damaged. And injuries of these types are called as musculoskeletal disorder, MSDs. This is not MSDS, so don't confuse with MSDS. This is MSDs, right? Musculoskeletal disorder. Muscles, right? Skeletal and disorder. So it's it comes from 3 words, musculoskeletal and disorder. So have you seen that some people who are working in IT department, or those who are working in software houses or in finance department, their job for 8 hours, 9 hours, who are working in the offices, is with the computer. So sometimes you will find they are using the collar, neck collar, right? They are using the neck collar. So it's due to the problem that they keep their postures wrong. So it is going to affect on the backbone. It is going to affect on the neck bone. So we can have this kind of problem. So this is one of the hazard which we can identify in our offices, the ergonomic, right? Especially because on production side, on operation side, on construction side, we have too many hazards. But in offices, we also have some hazards. And one of the most ignorant hazard is about the ergonomic. And that's why this IKEA and other big brands, they are claiming that our furniture is ergonomic friendly. And if you are using our furniture, then there will be very less impact on your health, adverse impact on your health. So, which is a good thing. Oh. Okay. So, ergonomic and risk factors. Ergonomic studies the various risk factors brought to a job. There are 3 main areas which are ergonomic risk factor, where the risk of ergonomic factor exists. Number one, risk factor inherent to the worker, risk factor inherent to the task, and the activity which he is going to perform, or you can say that the environment where he is working. For example, those people who are driving the dumpers, those people who are driving the bobcat, those people who are driving the trailers, when they are driving, they are passing through mountains to hilly area. So those people who are involved in this hilly activities, drilling activities, so all the time their body is vibrating. So when we have too much vibrating, then this will cause us musculoskeletal disorder. So MSDs is a group of conditions that involve the nerves, tendons, muscles, and supporting structures such as intervertebral discs. They represent a wide range of disorder which can differ in severity from mild periodic symptoms to chronic and debilitating conditions, which means that they can have more impact. So you can see that the first example is the carpal tunnel syndrome. What is carpal tunnel syndrome? This is the carpal tunnel syndrome, that our wrist, when you are working too much on the keyboards or when you are using mobile too much, right, all the time, tick, 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 like, so you can have the problem of carpal tunnel syndrome, where your nerves, the blood is going to be stuck here. And it becomes red, and it becomes too much, it becomes very red, and swelling starts. So this problem is carpal tunnel syndrome. And one of the problem which can arise is the tension neck syndrome. Tension neck syndrome is this one. So if your postures are incorrect while you are working on workstation, for example, on your laptop or your desktop, or you're working on for some other activity, so tension neck syndrome is possible. And then another, which is one of the example, is the low back pain. So if we are lifting or we are pushing or pulling in an in an incorrect way, then we can have the low back pain. And these are some of the examples of MSDs. MSDs are often confused with ergonomic. Ergonomic is the science of fitting workplace condition and job demands to the capabilities of workers. Or in other words, MSDs are the problem and ergonomic is a solution. So the problems or the disease which we are going to face are our MSDs. And to have the solution, how we are going to improve these activities are due to the ergonomic. Yes, guys, any question? Manji Usama.
No, sir.
आपने अपना दीदार करा दिया हमें आज. हमारी मेहनत वसूल हो गई.
कैसे हो गया?
MSD. It's okay, यार. I mean, I appreciate it. Open the camera, at least we can see. Sometimes it seems that I'm talking with the wall, I'm talking with the furniture. So in my last course, I asked everyone to must remain your camera on, so at least we can see. We can see now. It is mashallah very beautiful, and we haven't seen him in last 3 days. we missed this opportunity to see Mr. Irteza. Sajjad, we have already seen him. So, but don't worry, during the exam, it is a mandatory requirement to turn on your video. And also, keep your ikama or ID card with you during the exam. We need to verify if it's you or someone else. Maybe the exam of Irteza is being written by Murtaza. Khalas, then.
No, sir. We'll be giving the exam together.
Yeah, that's why I'm saying that there should be no one available in the room when you're writing the exam.
He lives in separate accommodation.
Uh-huh. Pretty. Zulmayar. Okay. So, MSDs, the contributing factors could be awkward postures, repetitive motion, forceful exertions, and pressure point and vibration. As I told you, these all are the possibilities due to which we can have the MSDs problem. There are also environmental factors which are associated with the workplace that can cause problem. For example, extreme high temperature. If you are working in high heat area or very cold, for example, if you are working in a cold store rooms, we have some clients having the cold store room. For example, Unilever, they keep their cheese and ice cream and everything like in the cold store. So here the temperature is, it goes up to minus 24. Sometime it goes up to minus 40 where the meat is going to be stored. So, and when you are going in these rooms, you have to wear the special dress, otherwise you can't survive for a long time. So these kind of the problems are common with the MSDs, and these can have impact like decreased blood flow, muscle strength, and manual dexterity. Manual dexterity is that even you cannot handle the spoon, it will become very difficult. For example, have you seen old people sometimes, their arms are always vibrating? So these are also possible when, even if you are not old, you are young, but you are having MSDs problem, then these kind of issues are possible with you. Work-related MSDs are nothing. Then those MSDs which are causing due to your work, we call it WMSDs. And these, the symptoms are like pain, numbness, and tingling, reduced worker productivity, lost time from the work, temporary or permanent disability, inability to perform job, and increase in worker compensation costs. I told you before that the studies shows that in last couple of years, the employees are getting more absenteeism due to the health issues rather than safety issues. So sometimes when we are unaware, our company is unaware, our safety department is unaware. So we are just giving them sick leave. We are just giving them, rest without knowing the cause. We just think that he is tired, so he need the rest. Since he has, he has done the overtime for last 6 days. So now let's give him one day off so he can take rest. But ultimately, if he is continuing this kind of activity, then he can have the MSDs problem. And sometimes if you see those workers who are involved in the manual handling, those workers who are involved in, repetitive posture activities, repetitive working, they have these kind of problems very common, and they get the absent due to these issues. So, any question?
No.
Okay.
Thank you.
Let's see the video. MashaAllah, we have now
this nine, type of work. This type.
10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Yes,
these type of works are related. No, I mean this work related MSDs. I feel these type of work is mostly for office based issues.
No, it could be on the production line. It could be on the construction area.
It should be with problem with operators.
Yes, definitely, because operator, they have to remain on the machine all the time. They have to watch whatever the things are going on.
Sometimes operator have to watch at angle of 75 or 80, 90 angle. It may cause problem with his neck.
Sometimes those miskin guys, I have seen the in the pharmaceutical companies, when you are preparing the injections, ampules, the small bottles of injections are called ampules. When they are preparing, then the ampules are coming out and they have to do the visual inspection. So their eyesight is like they are dummy. They have eyesight all the time open. So because if any foreign particle, if it is going into the ampule, it will be a very problematic. Although there are the sensors available, machines are available, but still the human vision is very smart, and it can pick a very small particles as well. So those guys are really miskin. They are, when the bottles are going, ampule bottles are going, they are just watching. I mean, they cannot, move from here to there because it's their duty. It's a continuous line. So the bottles are coming all the time. Yalla, can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes.
Can you?
Yes.
Good.
When people hear ergonomics, they often think of this. But in truth, ergonomics is simply fitting the workplace to the worker, rather than the other way around. And that includes lots of workplaces: construction, manufacturing, transportation, healthcare. You get the idea. So today, we're going to cover some ergonomic basics that apply to virtually any workplace. These include proper posture, managing forces, and excessive repetitive motion. Ready? Let's start with posture. Sitting, standing, walking, it really doesn't matter. Proper bone and joint alignment is key. So straighten up that back, keeping ears, shoulders, and hips in a straight line. Good. Now squat by hinging at the hip. Keep everything aligned. Now sit. Perfect. Maintaining that posture through your day and work, any work, will reduce fatigue, eliminate strains, decrease stress on joints and ligaments, and have you feeling great. If posture is good, forces are evil. Why? Because they assault your posture constantly. There are lift and carry forces, grip forces, push and pull forces, and just plain old gravity. Hey, let's help you out with this. To avoid injury, don't lift, pull, or push too much. Let your posture guide you. And if need be, get help or use a hand truck or other tool. Also, move that body. If you stand up a lot for work, sit. If you've been sitting, stand up. Every change is an opportunity to realign and think about your posture. Our last Ergo 101 topic is repetitive motion. Doing the same task over and over and over and over and over and over, you get the point. Repetitive motions from jobs like these, carpal tunnel syndrome, joint problems, poor circulation, and more. Fortunately, these injuries are easy to avoid. First, by arranging your work area to fit you and support good posture, and second, by stretching. Stretches like this, or this, or this, well, maybe not that. Every 30 to 60 minutes can make a world of difference and prevent injury. Show off. Let's recap. Ergonomics is all about fitting your work environment to you. So set up your station to support good posture. Be mindful of posture, reduce forces, and take breaks to stretch and realign yourself. Do all that, and you'll be on your way to being more efficient, more productive, and healthier. For tip sheets on setting up workstation.
Yes, guys.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Shall we continue, yes, or?
Enough for today.
I think enough for today.
Yes,
I think you're... I think your internet also has some ergonomic problem. That's why we are getting the voice.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Sometimes also my internet becomes having an ergonomic problem. Okay. Guys, tomorrow, inshallah, we will have last day. And not, I mean, last day for this course, not for our last meeting. Inshallah, we will be in touch. And, but for this course, it has to be end, right? The thing is, tomorrow we will be covering our remaining topics, which are, I think, 4 to 5 topics are remaining. These are also small topics, and I hope within 2 hours or maximum 2.5 hours, we will be finishing these topics. And then there will be an exam. The exam will be open book, right? We will share a link on Zoom with a Google Doc. You will be opening the link, and you will write the information, and you will be doing your exam paper. While you will be doing the exam paper, two, three things are very important, which I'm going to tell you now, so you can be prepared yourself. The first thing is that your camera will be open, right? You should have your ID card or ICAMA or whatever the identity you have must be available, and the name in the exam and your ID should have the same name, right? And similarly, I'm not saying, I mean, the order of the name or the spelling of the name, but for example, if you are Mustafa, then the, in ICAMA also, there must be a Mustafa, right? So, and then no mobile is allowed. I mean, mobile in a sense, those who are attending the course on mobile, it's okay for them. But other than, no other devices are allowed. You will be sitting in a separate place, in a peaceful place where there is no such distortion, and there is no one to, you know, guide you further on this thing, as during the whole exam your camera will be turn on. And during the exam, if you have any problem, you can just raise your hand or you can ask me directly. Right? So all the best. The exam is not much hard, but definitely it's hard for those people who are not going to prepare. Whatever we have discussed from the book, whatever we have discussed from the slide, the things will come from there. There will be nothing from outside. And keep in mind that the 17% are the passing marks. Okay? Any questions?
Example be multiple choices, right?
15 multiple choice question answer and 15 true false. Okay. Total 30.
Is there a bank question or something?
No, there is no descriptive question. There is no negative marking.
Anything will there else? Will there be multiple choice questions as well?
15 multiple choice questions.
Oh, okay. Not MCQs, false. But multiple. All right.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you so exam much.
Exam day is tomorrow, sir? Right?
GG.
Sir, can you guide some sort to for our preparation? Or the, can we have some?
After each chapter, you are having the preparation question answers, right?
Yes,
we are
sir.
Asking you. So the same pattern will be in the exam.
Okay, okay. Any specific exercise for preparation?
The specific exercise I can only share you tomorrow as an exam. Okay.
And when the exam will be for the?
Sorry?
Exam date for exam.
Tomorrow, inshallah. Just after exam. The
thing. Oh, tomorrow will be tomorrow.
Yes. I mean, we have, you know, we have finished the story and now you are asking when we have the exam. It seems that now you are tired. See, when my battery is down, I ask the same kind of question. But anyway, yes, inshallah, it's tomorrow as per our plan. This was a 4-day course and we will be in first 2 hours. We will try to cover our all topics and then we will take 10-15 minutes break to get easy. And then we will start the exam. So don't worry about it. Okay?
Okay.
Khalid, clear?
Clear, clear, sir.
Any question?
Thank you.
Okay, guys. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Good night. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Love you.